Okay. I remember clothes being sold like crazy. And for a few hours, it looked like a total clearance of big department store. In 8 hours, 20,000 people visited us. And revenue for some sellers, as I remember, reached almost 30,000 zlotys. That's more or less how in 2013 looked Hash Warsaw, the biggest fashion event that ever took place in Poland and for which I rented with my team a national stadium. Back then, I remember everybody loved us, and I felt I found finally my true sense of mission. I think it's because we all cared. We all thought we want to create something better. I wanted to unite the Polish fashion industry, to raise the quality, maybe even to compete with the big shopping malls and give the people an alternative for fast fashion shopping. But apparently, it was much too much for my ego. So anyway, 11 editions of fashion events gathered 200,000 people and over 500 designers. It all led us to the greater scale. We opened Hash Warsaw International, our e-commerce store, Fashion Map, Fashion Magazine. We organized fashion shows, and we cooperated with the biggest brands in Poland. But after 5 years and one therapy later, I didn't feel really well, so I asked myself a simple question. Where are you heading, Anna? Remember, you've had a mission, right? You wanted to raise the quality, unite the fashion industry. So where was it? Where are you heading? I started to notice more flaws on my beautiful fashion picture. I realized that I'm completely burned out. I felt that fashion stole my smile, and I had no idea how to bring it back. I also realized that only few designers back then knew anything about the textiles they use, the water usage, carbon footprint, the dyes inside. Actually, I think a few years ago, only experts used phrases like supply chain or sustainability. How is it possible? If fashion has been here since forever, that we know so little about how and where our clothes are really made. University of Florida discovered recently that humans started to wear clothes 170,000 years ago. Fashion should tell a story. In the past, it had the ability to take people to the streets, to fight for equality. So what's the story behind fashion today? Okay, the whole fashion market is worth approximately $1.7 trillion. It's comparable to the GDP of Canada. It hires 160 million people and it's still growing. And yet, we know almost nothing how and where our clothes are really made. Imagine the same situation with financial system. We know nothing about our money, where it comes from, where it goes. We don't know the transaction number. And there is no one online willing to respond our questions. Impossible. But speaking of finances, who of you here was never tempted by the charm of Black Friday? You know, all these magic tricks, minus 50, minus 90, because you're going to get a free candle or maybe a car if you buy two items, candle in the car. So anyway, it's Black Friday 2017. I went to a fast fashion store. And, oh, if you're not familiar with the term of fast fashion, these are all the brands that are offering you new merchandise 52 seasons a year. We, the people, call them weeks. They call them seasons. But anyway, I'm there in the fitting room with the trousers I wanted to buy and apparently with another 10 pieces of clothes because it was discounted. And suddenly, all of the questions I was so afraid to ask so far hit me like a bomb of anxiety. What am I actually buying here? Why does it smell like plastic? Why is it so cheap? Who made it and how? I behaved like a clothing junkie, checking all the labels, which stated simply nothing. And I think for the first time in my life, I've had like a serious panic attack. Then I just tried to inhale, exhale, and just thinking about Dalai Lama or Buddha or whatever to calm down myself. And I just decided to talk to that love of my life. And I said, Fashin, honey, I loved you with all my heart, seriously. You've been so supportive for so many years. You've helped me earn some money, meet amazing people, but apparently you're a freaking liar. And I think we need a break. So back then I made a promise. Unless fast fashion industry will start to produce with the respect for the people and environment, I won't buy any new garment from fast fashion production. Now, it's been 2 years since I made my decision. Later, I closed my company, I said goodbye to my team, and I started to detox my closet. I did it very simple, just dive deep down to the bottom of it, I checked what I have, what I really need, and then I sold, I donated and gave away the rest. And today, I can say, honestly, my closet fits into two famous blue bags. No commercials here. Okay, maybe three if you include shoes. But anyway, after this Marie Kondo treatment, I felt it's time for a re-revolution. So, I traveled all around Europe to meet experts and specialists, to know more how broken really is the supply chain and how can we repair it. I just sat down again to replan my life's mission, but this time it was in the long term. During that time, I discovered so many severe facts about fast fashion production. I thought my head would just explode and my heart would fall into pieces. I would like to share with you just a few of them today. First of all, fast fashion production emits more CO2 to the atmosphere than all the flight companies together. In 2015, production of polyester emitted over 700 billion tons of greenhouse gases. It's more than if you would sit in a car and go around the planet 1,400 times, even without a pee break. Water pollution. Fast fashion production is responsible for 20% of all the water pollution around the world. In China, there is a sad but true saying that by the color of the river, you may know the color of upcoming season. So if it's red, your cute dress probably is gonna be red next season, right? One t-shirt, you probably heard this fact already, it's quite famous, consumes more water than an adult person will need over the course of 2.5 years. 2,500 liters. Pair of jeans, 3 times more. 60% of our clothes contain plastic and carcinogenic dyes, even causing a breast cancer in women. And how the work in factories look like? Well, Let's see. You have to work from 12 to 14 hours a day. You have to sew from 100 to 150 pieces per hour. And then you earn from 90 euro per month in Bangladesh to even more shocking 23 in Ethiopia. How is it possible that at the same time, the owner of the biggest Spanish fashion group earns 500 euro per minute? We all know that something here is terribly, terribly wrong. But despite all these harmful facts and lies of fast fashion, I feel like we're finally awaking from consumers' coma. We feel that the change is inevitable, that the fashion needs a serious rehab because it suffers from lack of honesty. It still turns a blind eye from the elephant in the room. It's ill. But we know that together we can change it. Last summer, the text I wrote about my fashion rehab was read by 500,000 people. Also, in last years, a fashion revolution movement gathered a few hundred thousand people, mostly in Europe. If you're not familiar with fashion revolution, this is the movement that encourages us to know more about the true cost of our garments. But their most popular action is to encourage us to turn our clothes upside down, check our tags, make a photo, and ask the brand, "Who made my clothes?" and wait for their response. Last year, almost 5 million people joined this action. Also, hundreds of brands around the world, still small, but growing, started to produce their garments from trash. They just thought that garbage is the only infinite material we have right now. And I don't mean here obvious PET bottles, because you're probably familiar with that, but also fishing nets, coffee waste, orange peels, grape skins, used tires, even cow manure. Also, the most responsible brand in the world, Patagonia, is donating 1% of their annual revenue to protect the nature and support the activists. The business of renting, reselling, and repairing clothes is growing, and it's estimated to reach the size of fast fashion market in 11 years. So, as you can see here, the wiser way of using clothes, it's not only an idea of few rebels or eco-freaks, but the only common sense response to the limited resources. But this is the big picture. Now I would like to share with you a few tips. What can you do? And start where you are, use what you have, and do what you can to wear more consciously. First of all, investigate your wardrobe. Look what you have in there. Dig in it. The most sustainable clothes are the ones you already have. Second of all, choose your personal style over fashion. They're delivering new merchandise almost every week. But are you sure you needed flip-flops with a fur or two short pants last season? What's your style? You know it. Check it out. Use Good On You application. You can scan easily your tag and check what's your favorite brand rating. Is she really doing something good for the environment, or it's just a greenwashing? Choose quality over quantity. Most of us don't know, then we spend much more for fast fashion brands than if we would go to buy in secondhand some real good quality clothes or even new ones, but just the ones that are going to last for longer. But on top of that, there is one king or queen of all questions. what's the true cost of your clothes. Because as Lucy Siegel says, there's always somewhere someone who pays a true cost of our clothes. Before the speech, I was asked to water down my tone just a little bit, not to scare you, not to make you panic, but it's not me. So I decided to speak from the center of my heart, because I think it's not a time to whisper about the crimes of fashion industry. It's not a time to be concerned when overconsumption and overproduction is softly killing us. It's a time to use the right language and name the crimes by their true names, as we did with the climate change. It's time to call an accident in factories a crime. Industrial pollution, suicide on nature, ecocide. Slave job, it's a killing labor. An old school language would tell you, just do three R's, reduce, reuse, recycle. Okay, cool. But it's not enough anymore. I have for you three new words. Just don't buy. How simple is that, right? Because it's not a good deal if you don't really need it, right? Anyway, I truly believe that in capitalism, we can vote with our wallets and spend our hard-working money for a better purpose. I truly believe that none of us here would like to exchange the clean, beautiful river or green forest for more products in the shopping malls. I truly believe we have the power to change the world around us, step by step, but then by protesting and demanding immediate changes. I truly believe that people care when they know. And now, when you know, you can start to care.